Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're after Sacramento River Fall Chinook, and then it's Lake Berryessa Trout. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television.
Here we're getting ready to tie up some Brad's Killerfish, and we have some fresh crawdad tail and some really fresh sardines. It's been brining all night with Procure Bloody Tuna and Procure Krill, and it has a whole nother smell. Without that, you're just like everybody else. But with the scent, we've been using it all year, and it's really, our lure bites went way up. But we're gonna take the crawdad tail though right here, and you've got it's kind of round, so we kind of just cut little pieces and flatten it out so it ties up real good with a pair of scissors. So now you have it kind of flattened out. You'll set it down. You'll take one of your fillets. It's been pre-cut. I just soak them overnight. Of course, you're just gonna run it in your. This is a Kenai Rainbow by Brad's, and it's the hottest lure out here right now by far. This week right now, this lure's been incredible. So we're gonna start off with that. We'll take your little crawdad, put it in between the crack, just like so. Just get everything lined up, get it straight. You have your stretchy thread. I always start up towards the top. Okay, we're gonna run up river. We got a new spot. We named it the Duck Pond. It's a real shallow spot. It's on the backside of an island that hardly anybody even drives through there, let alone fishes there. So very rarely, like actually one time in 30 days, I've seen somebody fish there. So.
This morning, we're on the Sacramento with guide Wraith Herford, who's joined by Ernie Merlot of the Fish Sniffer magazine, Kevin Carmichael, and Brittany King, who's deckhanding for Wraith, and also Pup. And this morning, the duck pond is producing early.
Fish on? Fish on.
Fish on.
What do you want, baby?
Like this.
What we're doing is we're pulling it out because it's full of trees right there. Mm-hmm. We've been losing them in the snags.
We lost a big fish over that tree last week.
Kenai Rainbow. It's been the hottest lure in the Sac River right there. That thing's been on fire. For me, that's been the best lure out of every lure they've sent me. That's been the best lure in the box, and they all work. But that one right there, that lure was so hot. Good job, Brett. Okay, this is a Brad Kenai Rainbow Killerfish. This bait's still good. It'll be fine for at least one more fish. When it soaked all night in the krill and the bloody tuna. So we're gonna run it one more time real quick, because we're kind of on a time. We wanna get as many bites in there as we can. So. We're gonna run it again. It should be fine. That's why we wrapped it so tight up above. We got one little loose piece here. With stretchy thread, you just wrap it, rewrap it right around it. It'll be fine. But we're gonna go back in right now and get another one. This lure right here, it's been on fire all year also. That's caught more fish this year than any other lure, but in the last week and a half or so, the Kenai, the greens came on. This one's come on the last week. But this one will catch fish today too. These two lures right here are red hot right now. Okay, we're way up on the Sacramento River.
below Red Bluff, above Las Molinas. And this area holds a lot of fish because the water temperature this year has been running about 61, 60 in here, heating up to about 65 in the afternoon. And so normally we'd fish Chico and that, which there's a lot of fish there now, but the water's still 65 degrees, 64, and pretty warm in that area, even though they're doing good in there now, but it took them a long time to get going. So we moved up in here in this area about, just about a month now. And so this is where we've been fishing due to the feather not having any water in that. So for this year, this has been the ideal spot for us, this area, right here on the Sac River. So.
Welcome back to the Sacramento River. I'm Justin Wolf. It's a perfect morning for salmon fishing, and Brittany King has the first hookup of the day on a Brad's Killerfish. The drought conditions in Northern California have had serious implications on the fishery, but those who have made the correct adjustments to find the most optimum conditions available are having good success despite the low, warm water. We're hoping for the lure bite to continue this morning, but as the hot sun hit the water, the fish developed an appetite for procured roe. So we're running downstream to a stretch of water ideally suited for boondoggle roe, which is simply drift fishing roe with your baits upstream of the boat, which allows you to cover lots of water. And it's a technique that can be extremely effective.
So what we're doing now is we're boondogging. We're going up into the current, turning the boat sideways, lining everybody up on the side of the boat to cast upstream. We're using a light slinky weight with Procure Row. You want a puff ball and about a 15-pound leader. Number two hook. If your hook's too big, you get snagged up too much. So we're running a number two hook. I had a good friend tell me to use that hook because he's having a good success rate on landing fish also. So real crucial, number two hook, 15-pound leader, and a loose drag. Not too loose where you can't reel at all, but that would be ideal as a loose drag, number two hook, and about a 3-foot leader. And we're just gonna drag and comb the bottom. Everybody gets their own lane, so everybody gets to fish fresh water. It's not like back trolling or back bouncing where everybody in the back of the boat catches the fish. So.
Head tricks. Yeah.
He'll get a lot bigger when he gets to the boat.
He just got bigger.
He just got bigger. He just took off.
There he goes. I saw color for a second. No, it's gone.
I thought he was smaller for a minute.
He was. He was just coming down with the current.
Here you go.
Hold on, let me go up there.
Go to the front. Go to the front.
Let me go up there. There we go. Ooh, nice one.
Lift, turn him.
Nice fish right there. Thank you.
Good job. Yeah, when the lure bite slows down, we always switch over to row. Whether it's dead sticking this year because of the clear water, low water, we're trying to find current. The fish are sitting in the current and we're just boondogging or bobber fishing. A lot of people are bobber fishing.
Good
but
job,
what we did is we lightened our weights up a lot and we're just barely, you're barely tapping the bottom. And we're coming through, there's a lot of trees where we're fishing. So losing a lot of setups, but the fish are laying in them. Ernie floated that bait perfect right through them and it was a textbook. Boondoggle bite, it just went down, started pumping. Real important just to barely lift up and let the hook kind of catch a piece of meat. It's real important to have the right piece of bait. You don't want a great big piece of bait, but just a little dime-sized piece, and you have your puff ball, that'll help float it up off the bottom. But you just want a little piece of bait, and don't yank. You have to lift, let the hook just slide through the fish's mouth, and catch a piece and you just lift it and then you finish it. Once you feel it on there real good pumping. You just finish it off, and that's just a, that's why it's real important to have a little piece of bait. Let that hook do its job. So let's go catch another one. He was right by your log, huh, Ernie? He was, that, the fish was
good
right,
job, Ernie.
There's a big tree right down the bottom when you come off that point. And if you drag right next to it, you have a 50-50 shot of a snag or hopefully a fish.
That tree a lot of times will hook fish in front of it, then they run underneath it, and then we lose them. They get hung up in there, but it was able to come up and out. Lift them nice and slow to me.
It's one of the newer ones we're looking for.
Most people use a spinning rod with this. It's easy for clients to cast in that. I prefer a bait caster, but spinner rod still. But if you look on this fish, the hook's just barely on a piece of skin right there. If he would have set the hook, it would have ripped that skin out. But he lifted nice and slow. It's a nice long rod. He lifted up nice and slow, boom.
Launched out of Markley Cove on Lake Berryessa with guide Rick Kennedy, who's fishing with Todd Storm and Don Newman of P-Line. Berryessa has developed into one of California's top fisheries, partly due to a pen rearing program established back in 1999.
Right over there is some pens that California Fisheries Foundation puts in and maintains every year. They plant raised trout there and release them here every year, and that definitely has a lot to do with the trophy trout that we're catching this lake. It's a great opportunity and puts a lot of fish in the water.
Berryessa is loaded with trout, and this time of year, most of them are feeding on shad near the surface. So if you can find the bait fish, you're likely to find some great fishing.
Okay, we're heading up into what they call Rag Canyon. We're going along here looking up into all these little fingers to see if there's birds working, and as soon as I spot some birds, we're going to go back up into one of these little creeks and inlets and start throwing some spoons and see if we can't get some fish.
Oh, it's wet.
You putting that dot on to try and simulate a small threatened shad?
That's my secret weapon.
It's not so secret anymore.
What color you got? Oh, you got the pearl one? Okay, let's try that one for a little while. And if you don't get something pretty quick, we're gonna switch over to the pink. The pink was the hot one yesterday in here.
Got it on the front here. Check it out.
Today we're gonna be using 1/2 and 3/8 quarter laser minnows. And basically there's a lot of shad schooled up in the back of these coves. So the trout have kind of got them balled up, and we're gonna find the bait balls and see if there's some fish holding.
We're going to move up here in the head of this little cove here where those birds are working. It's going to get a little shallower, so you're going to have to just retrieve a little faster, but there's a bunch of fish up in there, a lot of bait.
Got some threadfin shad here. So hopefully it'll make them bite, eat it. So we'll just put a little bit on there on both sides of the spoon.
There's one. Take your time, Don. Let me get the net.
Okay.
Right at the end, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, it seems like when you try to first take them up, they, nice. Nice little rainbow.
A 12, 13 inch rainbow. Clean fish, look how bright they are.
This is actually a little smaller than the ones we were catching yesterday. That's always the case, right?
I'm gonna switch colors right now. I'm gonna go to the laser minnow 1/2 ounce pink. It seems to be working, getting a little more bites on that. I was using the shad color, but we'll get a little more flash and a little more color in the pink here.
Right, that one hit it as soon as that spoon hit the water. It hadn't fallen more than a foot.
This fish
jumping and boiling everywhere. Nice little trout.
That's a nicer fish. Powder anyway, it looks like.
Yeah. Boy, they're just hammering these spoon.
Aren't they? They love them things.
God. So I just put a little perk here on a little while ago, so I just put a little more on. About every, 15, 20 minutes probably. To get that scent trail going, because yeah, we're fishing pretty fast, so you want a little scent trail right on top so they can follow it and find the spoon and bite it.
So for this type of fishing on the spinning reel, we're using 6-pound CX Premium. Main reason is the castability. We can make real long casts. We're seeing fish kind of blowing up all over this this cove, and we can cast to where the boils are at. In other situations, we've got some reels with the halo, and the halo is 100% fluorocarbon. It's a mist green color, and it sinks a little bit faster when the fish get a little bit more spooky, because the invisibility factor works a little bit better. So we're using two different lines out here today.
So I threw that little red UV crypt lure on there and threw it out there against the bank and kind of let it just fall off the with the ledge there, kind of try to work it down, and hooked up right away. Dawn, you want to take this?
No.
Here, take it.
I don't need a handout just yet. Nope. Absolutely not.
Todd, you want it?
Guys, gotta have a little
problem. I want to see how pro fights a trout.
I'll probably lose it.
Come on, let's see how you do it. Oh.
It's a stinking bass.
It's a bass.
I don't believe it.
Oh, it's a nice spot though.
A crip lure, a bass on a crip lure. Wait till I get a hold of Morales.
Right?
Yeah, maybe I ought to start entering some tournaments.
Yeah.
He doesn't want to come up.
Spotted bass. Watch, it has teeth.
Never thought I'd see the day that I caught a bass.
Welcome back to Lake Berryessa. I'm Justin Wolf. It's the middle of November, the lake has turned over, and we're getting fish on just about every cast.
Man, they're so predictable. They get up and they start chasing the bait, and they're, you throw anything near them and they'll eat it.
Need the net, Don?
I don't know.
It's better without it.
Oh, he's gone.
Perfect.
Nope, don't need the net, Rick.
Yeah.
Most of the time, finding feeding birds means feeding fish, but none of this can happen without a healthy bait fish population.
Yeah, I've been fishing Berryessa for quite a few years, and we really lost a lot of shad population here on this lake for some reason, probably because of low water, but we've had quite a few years of high water, and we've had some really good shad spawns. So the shad are small right now, but we have a lot of shad in the system right now. So these fish are really benefiting from that, and we are too. So it's great. It's a great combination. Yeah, I like the new spot.
I'm going to drop it a little deeper and try and vertical jig it and see what happens.
Hey, we just had another one back here. They're literally almost every cast, huh?
Yeah. Oh, there he goes. He ate it right there.
That was awesome.
You got him going?
God, he would come up and spin on it. Look at it, 3-4 times.
We got a double going. Good job, guys. No pink laser minnow.
Oh, man. Nothing better.
You got him?
Yep, there we go.
Perfect. Good job.
We're getting them every cast now.
It's a terrible thing, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
One of the things that happens during the fall is when the water temperature starts to change, you've got the lake that turns over. And basically what happens is you've got a thermocline, and the water basically on the bottom, once that temperature switches and you've got cooler water on the surface and warmer water down below, the fish get active, the bait gets up on the surface, the fish chase them quite a bit, and that's why they've really gotten active right now.
Oh, big trout.
Good. good deal.
All right, double header.
Big trout.
Oh, that's a nice fish.
Yeah.
Beautiful fish.
Come on. Get in here. Nice one. That's what we're looking for.
Yeah.
That's a trout.
Now we're talking. Want to take him home for dinner? Look at that. Nice fish. Yeah, this is kind of a nice change for me because I spend, you know, 99% of my time trolling all these lakes for trout and salmon and what have you. And this is a treat when you can come out here and do something different.
About 11 o'clock right now, and I'm really ripping the spoon to get a reaction bite. They're really coming after it. Rip it up about 3 or 4 feet. They see it, they come and react on it. And so it's a really nice reaction bite right now. It's like every cast right now.
Nice clean fish, huh?
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.